So it must be nearly time, is it?
Yep. Yeah, right on.
Awesome. Hey, thanks for coming. Just before we... Now, Christian Copacciano is coming. He had some duties this morning in another part of the country, but he's arriving here. He's on his way as we speak.
Eventually.
And Christian has developed this app that we're trialing, playing with, seeing if how it's going to work for us. He'll talk all about that when he's here. Let me start with a prayer, and I want to talk about the opportunities that we expect to see this year and why this becomes so important, the training for the follow-up. As I look around the room, I've got some pastoral friends here that have done more of this than me. So we're going to learn together today. We want to discuss. I have some handouts to give you. I want to initially talk about the principles involved in follow-up and then some very specific things, but we want this to be a discussion. And understand the best way to become good at following up people, the very best way, guess what it is? Following them up. Let's go do it. And we'll talk about how you go and do that. We want to talk about general principles. The challenge with this is every situation's a little different. Every person's different. How the contact came about was different. They could be your auntie's neighbor. They could be someone that applied for a DVD off a TV ad. They could be a contact from a school or a direct one from a summer camp. So there's such, and there's another 20 that they could be. So they could be a letterbox card. They could be someone that put up their hand during a church service in an appeal like the pastor's made. There's so many different ways that people make decisions. This is looking at some general principles that we need to follow in doing that. So let's just bow our heads together and pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness and grace. And Lord, as we share this afternoon, as we look how we can become more effective in finding those that are searching for you, that want to be found by you, Lord, please give us the wisdom of heaven. Give us the confidence that you alone can instill in our hearts, that we can trust you and we can go forward in faith, knowing that you will be everything we need you to be. We pray in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen. I'm going to give you some handouts. If you guys could get those distributed for me. Thanks, Pete. There should be plenty there. Just one page, that one. There's another handout we'll do later. Sorry, Bruce. Oh. Do you need some more?
Probably will.
Folks, as was announced this morning, North New South Wales and It Is Written are becoming one entity. It Is Written is actually becoming part of North New South Wales. We have never had a TV program from It Is Written on at an hour that I would be awake at. Apparently there's been a 3 o'clock program, but I'm not even sure that was North New South Wales. It's usually Sydney, Brisbane, Melbourne, Adelaide, Perth, but the country misses out. That's all changing. As I just said before, people are still coming in. We are negotiating with Doug Batchelor and Amazing Facts right now, because Doug is already on TV in the capital cities, but he's not in TV in the bush. And I got information this week that just this year, the Amazing Facts TV ministry generated 8,000 contacts in Australia. They weren't passed on to churches, and we're going to change that. At least in our territory where we're responsible, we want to cooperate with any of these programs. The Voice of Prophecy, I've been reliably informed, is also coming to Australia. So there's going to be lots of TV opportunities. We've just been flooded by more people. That's great. Have they shut down another workshop or something?
Yes.
Justin, you were our first choice.
Tom's full.
I
love leftovers, you know. The next day, put it in the microwave, they taste really good, yeah. Can you hand those out? If we do, we need any more? Pete, there you go, mate.
You got any more the other side, and you got one yourself.
There's plenty there. So, folks, I'll kind of try and fire up again. We have lots of different opportunities coming through the media where we believe, by the grace of God, if churches advertise the program on the television yourselves in your area, that's your responsibility as local church. If you invite your friends and family, but most of all, you pray for these television programs. It's been demonstrated if Doug Batchelor could generate, there's more here if anyone else needs some. If Doug Batchelor's program in Australia just last year generated 8,000 contacts, that's a lot of contacts. Now, of course, we are not Sydney. We don't have that bigger population, but we certainly are excited that we have media opportunities. And as we heard in the offering promotion this morning, radio, I don't know whether you're aware, but right across from Woi Woi to Raymond Terrace, 87.6 is a radio station run by the Adventist Church. And you can hear that. Most places you get a bit of double up and things. It's a low power station, but I drive in my car and I can hear it most places between Woi Woi and Raymond Terrace. Certainly hear it at my home. And we have people listening into that. We have not yet promoted that until we get it ready. We want to be ready when we go, and we're going to have big billboards up for people to know there's Faith FM in this area. I don't know what area you're in and whether there's, I know in the Northern Rivers there's tons of radio stations. There's radio stations right across our conference. I think there were 56 before we even got this one. So we want to try as much as possible to be prepared for different interests and different leads that come to us. Has everyone got a worksheet? No one. Does anyone else need one? Because there's more left. Okay. Christian's going to come to us and share with us in a moment a new app that's been developed so we can make sure we're not losing interests. They're not falling through the gaps. And our dream would be that we would have trained ambassadors that would have a It Is Written shirt on. You go in the name of It Is Written. And when the interests come in, we direct those ambassadors to that interest. And that's where that app is going to be so helpful for us. That won't be everyone. But even if you're not an ambassador and you're not following that particular interest, we want to have a look at some principles involved in following up a lead. You're allowed to yell out, ask questions, do whatever you like in this space. God brings different opportunities to us with people he's trying to save. Is that true? The world's getting a very serious place. I don't know whether you kind of keep on top of current events, but 2016 is 500 years since Martin Luther has nailed his 95 theses there in Wittenberg on the church door. 500 years. The Vatican has got a lot of plans to reverse that event this year. Yeah. And they've been very public about that. It's all over now, the Reformation. Have you heard?
Yep.
It's all over, and we're all one big happy family again. Only the theology that was taught the day Luther did that is exactly the same today as it was then. That's not changed. So who's changed? The Christian world has changed. We have a massive role to play on planet Earth right now. And none of us are worthy of this. None of us have the ability or the giftedness to be able to do this on our own. But for some strange reason, God has raised up people to reach people. Why do you think he would do that?
It's people he's wanting to reach.
He wants to save.
as many people as possible.
He wants to save as many people as possible. These are all good answers. Yeah, sometimes he saves the people saving others.
We're all going through the same thing.
We relate better, don't we? It's amazing when a church that can be conflicted and caught up in different issues starts to focus on lost people, that all of our own issues seem to vanish. It's incredible. I think it's a really healthy journey you have with God when your experience with God directs you towards the needs of others and the salvation of others.
I think the other thing with it is that when you meet with other people, you're not the only one going through those very same issues.
You're not the only one. And I need to qualify some things. Some of us have been gifted very heavily towards evangelism. And in the Bible, they're called what? Evangelist.
Yeah, trick question.
They really, and I'm sorry, I just have a disposition for it. I don't know why, it makes my heart tick. It's exciting to me. Do you have to have the gift of evangelism in order to share your faith?
No.
We are all called, in Greek, I learned Greek in this classroom. It's coming all back to me all of a sudden. Martyrios, which is martyr or witness. We are all witnesses. That's the end of the Greek. It wasn't a great experience, actually. I'm having all these flashbacks. It's getting to me. We are all called to be witness in different degrees with our different capacity. But God can use a donkey in the Bible to give a message. I could make an illustration right now, but I'm not going to.
Go there, go on, you need to.
Who can God use? He can use a donkey to give a message, actually a verbal message. The donkey didn't even go Eeyore, the donkey spoke. And the crazy guy spoke straight back to it. So he was very angry that day. I want to give you confidence that if you don't know what you're doing, you are absolutely the right person to be doing it. The day you think you know how to do this, you're undone. And that's dangerous for us pastors because we do a lot of this. We can get confident and cocky. What do confident and cocky people do? Make mistakes.
You tell everyone else how to do it.
They take classes on it, you know. Confident and cocky people don't rely on God. And you can be a stammering person that can't even speak properly and do just fine in being a witness for God if you depend on Him. And it's the second point because at the end of that first little paragraph, it says the very best way to develop your skill is to just go and do it. Learn and develop your knowledge and skill through working for others. Do not think you have to have a PhD in witnessing or something before you go and do it. You just go and do it. Humbly and prayerfully. And it's amazing you'll see the miracles of God working right in front of you. Because one thing I am utterly convinced of is that all of heaven is interested in the salvation of lost man. All of heaven. So I like it when the church gets lined up with heaven and we have this beautiful alignment. If you are intensely interested, not a little bit interested, intensely interested in the salvation of others, you have the mind of God. Because the Bible teaches me again and again that He is not willing that any should perish, that all should come to repentance. Jesus gives His own mission statement in Luke 19:10. He says, the Son of Man came to do what? To seek
and save.
And to save that which is lost. We don't do the saving, we do the seeking. The very first point on here, prayer is the start and finish of follow-up. And it's Prayer can become just a quaint thing that we do. If you look in your Bibles at there's so many examples of prayer. If you come with me to James, the fifth chapter, it says in James chapter 5 and verse 17, I love this verse. It's a very, very powerful verse. This is very key in evangelism. James 5 and verse 17, it says, Elijah, you're getting ready for Christy, are you?
Yeah, good.
Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. What does that mean?
He had problems.
He had a few issues. He's like Days of Our Lives. He's got a few issues. You know, you just turn on Days of Lives and you'll be guaranteed. I haven't watched it for a few years. I just want to clarify. But I'm sure if I turned it on, I'd be able to pick up the story in about 5 minutes. From about late 1980s, nothing else changes. You'll go from drama to drama to drama. Elijah had a couple of issues. Just like you, did that disqualify him from doing ministry? In fact, it's put in there to encourage us. James says, he was a man with a nature like ours. He wasn't Jesus, he was Elijah. Jesus didn't have issues. Elijah does. Here's this guy with issues. It says he prayed, and it has a little word with it in my New King James. What does your Bible say? How does he pray? Earnestly. He prayed earnestly. When it comes to working for the salvation of others, I am utterly convinced that you have to pray earnestly and wrestle for people's salvation. And in our age, we've made prayer many things, but that wrestling with God in prayer for people is actually not natural to us. It's not natural to our culture. It's not natural to our age. And the most important thing that we can ever do for anyone else is intercede and invite heaven to get involved in their life. And I use some graphic illustrations of that. My wife and I were wrestling earnestly for my daughter today because she's not at church. And we're not going to stop wrestling for her. And it's so classic. She's there in Toronto. And I've told this story many places. I'll tell it again. We just pray all the time and work and pray. And by the way, there's a Bible worker seeing her. Is it next Sunday? It's just incredible what God does and how he brings people to their lives. But a lady pulls onto her front lawn. It was State of Origin. Her front lawn, because the poor lady can't see in the dark. She has her own camper van, and she drove the camper van right up onto their front lawn and parked it there for the night. As you do. Goes and knocks on my daughter's door and says, hey, I'm parking in your front yard for the night because I can't see anymore to drive. And begins to give her testimony. And during the testimony, she says how she met her husband at Avondale College. And my daughter starts to put two and two together and she says, are you an Adventist? And she was married to a pastor. Yeah, she's an Adventist, all right. And Monica says, oh, my dad's the conference president. And continue to be friends. That lady rings her up and still invites her to church. She stayed there the whole night. She was playing the piano in their house and everything that night. I can stand here and tell that story 1,000 times and you'll never tell me that was a coincidence. That's what God does. When we pray, God wants to get involved. But one thing about God I want to tell you, that he believes in liberty and freedom. Absolutely believes in liberty. He hates the dark ages where the church wants to governed by violence and control of others. God is into liberty and freedom. And he will not come and interrupt a party. He stands at the door, the Bible says, and what does he do? He does not kick it in. Prayer opens the door. God steps in. That's why we must pray, because he believes in liberty and personal freedom, so much so it's a part of his nature and character. And that's why Revelation 13, why it's all going to happen, there's no liberty left, there's no freedom to worship. That's why it's so opposed to who God is. God is into liberty and freedom. And prayer invites the guy knocking on the door, it invites him in. We must pray, and we must pray like Elijah, fervently. What does fervently mean? Passionate. It's the opposite of casual, isn't it? And indifferent. If you're fervent, I don't know how we use that word much, if you preach fervently, that means that you'll probably get spat on in the front row while the preacher's talking. He's that into it. He's really taking it seriously. Stanley, you had your hand up. Yeah. Well, we've got the garden. A Maroon supporter. Thanks for that. Don't get me started, man. The very fact that prayer shows that we cannot do what God has asked us to do without God. You cannot lead other people to Jesus. You cannot. But working with God, he can use you all the time. All the time. So, prayer will cover your inability and lack of knowledge. I believe there is something incredibly disarming about someone sharing their faith who doesn't know everything. When you have a degree in theology and years of pastoral ministry, you can be very intimidating to someone that doesn't know much. But when they meet someone that is not the epicenter of all theology and wisdom, that they're just someone like them, it's incredibly disarming to them. And they're much more likely to ask interesting questions. Glad to see you, Christian. Much more likely to ask interesting questions of someone that they know is not a professional theologian. That's just how it is. Your inability or your lack of knowledge is not a disadvantage when it comes to witnessing. I want to put it to you that in many ways it is an advantage. They ask what you do and you can say, well, I'm a plumber, or I work for 3ABN, or maybe that's not such an advantage, but if you just have an ordinary job and you work in that space, your lack of great wisdom and knowledge is an advantage for you when you share your faith. So prayer is the beginning and the end. And when you wrestle with people in prayer, the guy knocking on the door has the door opened. You're inviting God to come into that situation and get involved. And we must do more of it. Not casual prayer, as we say grace at night, where we are fervent, we actually take this as a life and death matter. The next point there is called courage and faith. Who finds it a little bit scary to go and meet someone new at their door? Put up your hand if you do. It's okay to be scared. And what's your biggest fear? Share some of the fears you have that you've been given this contact or lead and you're going to knock on their door for the first time. What's the worst thing?
It starts at the gate when you're wondering what the dog's like.
Okay, it's their pet rock wheeler. Okay, that's a good one. I've met a few of those actually.
Wrong house.
Okay.
Wrong time.
Rejection.
You might meet the husband
instead and he'll be angry. Anything else?
Answering objections.
Yep. Most of the fear centers around how it's going to get received. In most cases, the worst thing, I said most cases, the worst thing that can happen is they say, no, I'm not interested. Was that really painful? Remember when Samuel was no longer wanted to be the prophet, they want a king, and he got really bent out of shape, poor Samuel, and God said, hey, Samuel, calm down. They're not rejecting you, Samuel. They're rejecting me. So you have to play through. Yeah, they could be angry as a bull ant. But in this, you know, I used to pastor in Los Angeles, and there are some neighborhoods there that I really didn't know what I was doing when I went there, or I would not have went there. Especially when I first got there. At nighttime, I'd go into these areas where these Mexican gangs were ruling the streets, and I didn't know. So when you don't know, it's probably pretty good. But as soon as I found out, I didn't go back there much. That was the end of that. And I had a Bible study with a girl called Angela, and there were all these, you know, the cars that bounce up and down and all that stuff, and I just would wave to the guys, and they would think, I don't know what they thought I was. But in Australia, we don't have too many of that sort of gang shooting up people. There are parts of Sydney, okay? But in North New South Wales, we don't have a lot of that sort of stuff. There's the odd rock wheeler. And there's lots of ways to handle that too that we might have time to talk about. But generally, most people are going to be quite polite and respectful. But I will tell you this, to do evangelism, you need courage. The Bible has instructed us again and again. You look how many times the Bible tells us to be strong and courageous. To run a public, I believe the number one reason there are not more public evangelism programs is because of a lack of courage. How do I know that? Go and rent a hall, do all the advertising. What's the great fear of the evangelist?
No one will turn up.
No one comes. I've done one of those. I've done more than one. And it knocks the stuffing out of you. And you start to question everything about yourself and evangelism and everything else. And it's easy to forget that the Holy Spirit inspired the Bible. It's easy to forget that because it's Spirit inspired, it's a living word, and God said it never returns to me void. And when I remember that, I think, oh no, it's just tough. You get up and run another one. You've got to have courage and you've got to have faith in order to be involved in witness. And you must believe that God has spoken through this book, because that's the only reason you're there. You're going to share this message with someone that needs to hear it. And you have to be utterly convinced. And when the devil gets on your case and tells you, don't knock on the door, was that a dog's tail I saw behind that bush? And all that, all the little things he'll whisper in your ear. Remember that you are an ambassador of heaven and you're taking this book to someone that needs to know it. It's God's word. The Holy Spirit is alive and well. Yes? Amen. Therefore, this book is what people need. Courage. It's so easy. It's so easy to get discouraged. Discouraged. Look at the life of the disciples working with Jesus. It's this constant up and down, up and down. Jesus was trying to make them just on the level. You do it. It's a wonderful thing. If you go, knock on a door. This is terrible to say it's wonderful, but I'll give you my perspective. It's a relief to know that you go and did your part and the person wasn't interested. Because now you don't have to go out for the next 6 months giving a Bible study to that person. You got the night off. That's how I used to get, because I couldn't find enough nights in my week so I could get a spare bit of time. So a spare bit of time, if they reject it, I go, phew, that's one bit of work I don't have to do. People have made a response because they're interested.
There are thousands of people today where we live in our towns and cities that want to know about heaven. Ellen White says they are looking wistfully towards heaven. Have we got the courage to go and knock on their door? I don't want to say you don't need courage, because you do need courage.
Justin, courage is only courage when you take action.
Yep. It's not a theory. Neil said courage is only courage when you take action. Guys, this is nothing. You should see what they have to do in some parts of the world. We don't come up with this excuse, really. But I do know we'll come up with every little excuse in the book. The next heading says build a friendship with the person. This is something that was hard for me to learn. The reason you're delivering a DVD to the person, or a Bible study guide, or you're going around following up some interest or lead, the reason you're going there, I always thought it was about the DVD and then watching the DVD. It's not. Sure, it's a great DVD and everything like that, but you can actually watch all that online. You can find that in so many places, it's unbelievable. The reason you're going there is to build a friendship with that person. Because one thing I know for certain, you do not win enemies, you win friends. What would be some real blockages to you making friends with a person you're going to visit like this?
Being dogmatic.
Being dogmatic, that's right. Dogmatic.
Being critical.
Critical is a massive thing. You go there and they've got, they're having bourbon and coke and they're smoking a cigarette and I don't know what they might say to you, what language they might use, you'll hear everything. And you don't have to actually say anything, just the way that starts to grate on you will start to be projected on that person. And people will actually deliberately do things to try and get you to do that to them. So they get off the hook as well. They're trying to get off the hook, most people. They're convicted by the Spirit that they need to do something about this, and they love you to give them an excuse to get out of it. You can't give them one. Peter, you had a hand up.
Not listening to them when you first meet them and you try and take them, preach the whole gospel first, that turns them off straight away.
Yeah. It's Dan.
I was gonna say relatability is huge.
It's a real skill to be able to listen and ask the person questions about their life and find out what they're interested in. It's a perfect gift if they have a rock wheeler. Because guess what you talk about? Nice dog. How long you had the dog? Have you had one before? You know, where did you get him? Ask everything you can about them and their life, because you're building a relationship with that person. You want to know all about them, because next time you come back, guess what you'll bring up? How's your dog? Has he bitten anyone lately? You know? I got bitten by a dog once at a house. It jumped up and bit me on the backside. It was a cattle dog. Watch the cattle dogs. That's what I have in my yard now, because I know they work. The poor lady was so horrified that her dog bit me, it was like a perfect door opener. There was a question over here.
No, you were talking about things that might stop you being effective. My innate one is I actually don't want to get involved.
You're an introvert and you don't want the nuisance of someone else's life. Yes. It's a hassle.
Yes.
It is a drama, I agree with that. Yeah.
That's one of the biggest things. Yeah, you know, your life's very tidy and comfortable and you don't want their mess in your life.
It's a very insightful comment you're making.
You know?
Their mess in your life.
Yeah.
And they can be messy.
They can be very messy.
They can be very messy. And then we go back to the Bible and we get an insight into what God thinks of that person. And it's actually our love for God You only really love God by the way we love our fellow man. Whatever you did unto the least of these, my brethren, Jesus said, who did we do it to? Our love for God, how real is it? Well, it's clearly expressed in the mess we get involved with others, because it's a mess. There's no doubt about the mess.
But I think with that too is that there's the visible mess and there's the internal mess that we don't see, that we all have, but we tend to hide it very well.
The under the surface mess that we all have. That's good. That's a good insight. I just don't want their dramas. It's a good testimony. They're a human being. Remember that when you are going and first you're working for others, God is a relational God. Father, Son and Spirit, this amazing relationship that he has there. His desperate thing is to have a relationship with us. He made us relational. And there is an epidemic in Australia of loneliness. And we'll talk a bit as how, you know, some people will get you to come to the door. They don't have a spiritual bone in their body. They're just lonely. They're just lonely.
I think the Jehovah's Witnesses have a good system. When I was going to the Cabaret Beach, people are either going to the beach, going to the restaurant, or going into the hotel. But as they approached the beach, there was a stand. And on the stand, they had the Bible. But at the top was the Bible. So everybody that went either to the beach or to the restaurant or to the hotel saw the Bible. God was put before them. Yep. In the simple stand. And then two people sit over here, and they don't say anything. But then if you comment, they'll talk to you. They don't push you. And they have a system where those two people sit there, and then a bit later on, another two people come over. And in Coolumba, there's a park. It's called Knox Park. And it's in the centre of the town. And I usually go past, across the crossing park. When I go to my class at the gym. And there's a seat there, and it's sort of quite central. And they have their stand there, and all they do, two people, and they take a, you know, they do a shift, and they just sit on the seat, and they do nothing. They just sit there.
They wait for people to talk to them.
Yeah, you can walk past, and you can, you don't say anything to you. You know, you can just walk past. They're not going to try to stop you. They're not going to try to interrupt you.
No.
I
would say that they are very experienced soul winners. That's very, very smart. I pulled into a survey the other day and there's a guy there with his stand with polish on it. And he was just looking for his next victim. And I didn't want to talk to him. And I could tell he was going to come after me. So I just went straight in the survey and got on with life and then straight back to my car because I just didn't have time and I don't want any polish. Oh, it's a great system, and when we get to identifying a seeker, their system identified seekers for them. I just need to say this if you forget everything else I said. Remember that prayer works, and you can only help seekers. Two things. You can only help a seeker. You can sow seeds to other people, but it's only seekers that can actually be led into Bible studies that are productive. It could be. The fact they had the word up Bible, it's just like it's bait for a seeker. I used to put a picture of Jesus in my prophecy seminar ads in the paper because that's bait. A seeker is incredibly attracted to the person of Jesus. They just got to know about it. They do. They're seeking. In the relationship with people, it's really important that you're reluctant to talk about yourself and your stuff. I've been with people witnessing. They thought it was a sermon. as soon as the person would take a breath, they would dive in with their sermon. This is not the place to be preaching. This is a place to be listening. Don't give sermons. Don't think that you're doing God's duty by you talking the whole time. Listen, listen, listen. Don't talk about your own things. Ask questions about them. Let them talk and let them ask questions. Whether they ask questions becomes so fundamental to identifying whether they are seekers or they're just lonely. Seekers are the ones you can really help. And they are everywhere, but it's a skill. It's a skill that you learn to identify one. And people that are been working and soul winning, over time you start to develop that skill that you can pick up very quickly whether someone is a really good interest or not. But it's a skill that has to be developed. How are you going anyway, mate? I haven't even talked to you. And you doing all right? You know he's our new Union Personal Ministries Director. Give him a hand, eh? I'm going to get kicked to you here shortly, Christian. Okay, so you're ready, aren't you? Sorry. They do need help. Yep. And there are different ways you help a lonely person that you do a seeker. If you project all our stuff onto a lonely person, you're probably going to damage them. A seeker will just eat all that up and want more. A lonely person, you're probably going to bend them out of shape. So to identify someone who's lonely, it's quite legitimate to be lonely and to serve someone that's lonely in that. And there are ways we can do that. But a seeker will be very different. And if you don't help a seeker, they're going to go find someone else that will. And they could be the Mormons or someone that's going to give them some horrendous material. They will find something. So identifying a seeker and knowing what to do is really, really important. Any other questions or comments?
I think that is your approach to the person. Because when they open the door for you, your approach is so important.
It is.
Because if you smile and say hello, because I'm a registered nurse, and if I approach my patient, they don't like me. But if you approach the person in the right moment or in the right way, and you listen what they have to say to you or how they feel, you don't need to go straight away. With the Bible study,
no.
Assessment. You just let them, on my way to view, you let them say what they want, how they feel today, or if it is raining or it's sunny, something that they would like.
That's right.
And that you like to hear, then maybe.
Well, what I want to talk about now is how do I discern the lonely person from the seeker? Or some other person from, how do you identify someone as a seeker? And if you go over the page, it says, assess the person where they are in journey. The skill must be developed and learned. It's important to make accurate assessment of where the person is in their spiritual journey. You can only help those who are seeking. I've said all that. By the way, when you make these sort of assessments of people, you can be wrong. I've been wrong many, many times, but it is, you can really start to tell when someone is wanting to go further and do that. Don't be a pushy person who feels they have to push their beliefs onto everyone else. Australians hate that. They hate that. And you're not helping God's cause when you're doing that. If you can identify the person that they are really interested, well, that's a different matter. That's a different matter. Biggest tip, seekers ask questions. I love it when I'm introduced myself and people ask me, what do you do? It's really easy as a pastor. I say, I'm a pastor of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. What do I do next? I just watch and listen. Because I just put that out there. What's going to come back? They'll go, often they'll go, oh. Nothing else. The cogs are going, oh. And you know they're processing all that.
Better watch my language.
They'll often say, oh, my neighbour used to go, he was a Jehovah's Witness, or, you know, they have no idea, you know, they're just trying to build a bridge, they're just being friendly and all that, that's cool. Or they'll say, oh, my auntie's an Adventist. We used to go to Currumbong every Christmas and it smells like Weet-Bix down there when we drive into the town. I used to work at a civil engineering company, and it became apparent that I got converted and I wouldn't work on Sabbaths and all that stuff. There was one truck driver. There was 200 men worked in this company, and it was rough. They'd have cartons every afternoon just because they could, and drive home back in the day.
When you could.
When you could in Queensland, yeah. And anyway, one truck driver, Lenny, he used to give me hell. Every smoko, he'd bring up Azaria Chamberlain. Every time we'd sit down to have lunch, he would bring up something. There was another Adventist worked in the company operating a grader. He'd bring up how he doesn't work on Saturdays. Like, he couldn't leave it alone. What does that mean? He said, you know what? I left that company to go to college here. And the very morning I left, I can still remember where I stood on the road. He jumps out of his truck and he says, yeah, all my family are Adventists. He said, I was speechless at this point. He said, I actually was going to do the baker's course at Avondale College. They had me enrolled, and I couldn't believe how everyone looked after everyone down there. This guy had been convicted the whole way along. I just thought he was a real mongrel. I just thought he was just... But the fact he had to bring it up, the fact he had to react, tells you something. You want a reaction. The person says, oh, it's nice weather at the moment, isn't it? You know, and they just change the topic. That doesn't really mean too much. But the person that you get a rise out of, the person that's having a reaction, the best reaction is when they ask questions. I've always wondered, what do you guys do? Da, da, da. How come you do this? They've got 1,000 questions. That's a good indication that this person is a really wants to know more. They're the person that you get into Bible studies. David.
What do you do with the person who says, do you believe in da 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 da? And then when you say, well, you can say quite a few things to that, whether you believe it or whatever. And then you can see this mental tick, yes? He's because I've been studying with this guy, and it seems like his process is, I'm going to get this Adventist to come over to my way of believing, and I'm just checking out to see where he's at, so I know
yeah.
Where to.
He's not a seeker. And anyone that attempts to teach you, you're wasting your time, folks. You can go and do another barbecue with them, or there might be a lonely person. But the moment they're trying to teach you, biggest indicator there is that this person is not a seeker. And you'll get lots of people like that. I have had people that just love me coming around. And you would do Bible studies for 12 months, 18 months, and we seem to be at the place we were the day we started. They never seem to know anything more, even though I'd already done that before. They never seem to ever go to church or do anything about anything they learned. They are not seekers. They may be lonely. They may be just nice people, but they're not seekers. And like I say, where you give a Bible study and where you do a follow-up, it's when it's received right that it does its work. projecting that onto people that are not interested, you are wasting your time and their time. Do other fun things with them. Go play squash or cricket. But if they're not interested, if they have to always be the teacher, biggest indication they're really not people that are in a place that you can help. Seekers don't try to teach. Seekers have a great hunger to learn more. Seekers generally don't argue, but are accept what they're taught. Not always. Not always. I love to tell the story about Shifty Morris. Shifty Morris operated the excavator on our pipe crew. He was a wild man. He had a pretty crazy lifestyle on the moral side of things. And he mocked me every day of the week. I was the 7-day bike rider. He just had all these sort of names. He got that from Mormons ride bikes around, and we're 7 days, so we're 7-day bike riders. And he could not help, but jab at me every couple of times a day. The other blokes would comment about it. He wouldn't leave me alone. Again, what's that indicating? He's interested. He's digging in the excavator, he digs up over the top of Battery Hill in Kurrumundi, and as he digs through there, he digs up all these fossils, which actually do a bit in that sort of work. We always buried them again so we could keep going with the job, but he dug up all these fossils. I'm sorry, but that was it was Queensland back in the 80s, okay? These big, beautiful fossilised ferns. And they were in sandstone. And they were all the little fronds of it. I can't believe we buried them again, but we did, okay? Anyway, he jumps out of the excavator. I can still see him. He's standing on the track of the excavator. He's saying, did they get there in the flood, Justin? Did they? Yeah, you know, making a big joke. And I said, Shifty, we're on the highest hill in this whole area. And if a plant dies over there today, what's it going to look like tomorrow? It'll shrivel up to nothing. I said, that was buried instantly, set in stone on top of the highest hill. You tell me how that happened. I said, I can take you to Everest and show you seashells on the highest mountain in the world. How did that happen, Al? Alan Morris is his real name. I'd call him Shifty or Al, depend how I felt.
What was Shifty Al?
He got back in the digger, he got back in the excavator, and he never said a word. He was, cogs were going. I mean, my second year at college, we were living, I think, over in Napa Valley. A Saturday night, Al gives me a call. He says, Justin, I'm getting baptized tomorrow. I just want to ring you and thank you that you stood up for your faith. I would have thought, back then, I didn't know much, I would have thought this guy was the absolute enemy of the gospel. What was the Apostle Paul doing when he got converted?
Yeah, killing Christians.
If he was at home watching The Simpsons, you know he's not a seeker. But he was out killing Christians. This guy was full on. The ones that this scientist who's obsessed with Christians attacking us. What's his name? Dawkins. Oh boy, would I love to dig into that guy's life. He is so convicted. He cannot. It's like he's an evangelist against Christians. What's going on for Dawkins that he even cares? Why does he care? Why does he care? People, when they demonstrate to you they are seekers, you get them into Bible studies. Systematic Bible studies. Do not resist when they ask you questions. Seekers are full of questions. You do not provide answers. Unless you're sitting down, opening up the Bible with a set of Bible study guides, systematically, one by one, answering their questions. Don't satisfy their curiosity by giving them an off-the-cuff answer. What is this mark of the beast thing that you guys talk about? I said, yeah, man, that's so close to happening. I've got an excellent study on that. I should give it to you sometime. And then I take it away. I don't offer it to him again because I'm messing with him. He wants it even more now because I just gave it a little bit and I took it away. I never come out and say, oh, yeah, well, that's this, this, and this, and I give him a half-hour explanation just straight off the cuff. I don't do that. Because before I ever go near one of those questions, I want to start at study number one. This book, the Bible, where we're going to get your answer from, it's important we understand what this is. So let's start with what the Bible is first and how we study it. You systematically answer their questions. Do not give answers off the cuff. Resist it. Big mistakes I've made there. If you find a seeker that's full of questions, you give them the answers in a Bible study guide. I've got to hurry up here. What is the time? 3:30.
Just a quick question. What happens if they want to skip ahead?
You try and stop them from doing that, but sometimes you can't. Sometimes people will want to skip ahead, but they'll say, look, I'll say, they want to know about the Sunday law. Up in Papua New Guinea, one wants to know about the Sunday law. We can't go there yet. We don't even know about the Sabbath. Why would you want to know about all that? Well, hang on. You don't even know about our Saviour. Why would you want to know about the law if you don't know about a Saviour? So there's a reason evangelists do things in order. There's foundations that must be laid. If you dive to the end and you haven't laid a foundation, that building will fall over every day of the week. Lay a foundation. Make your first visit brief. Grave mistake. When you find a seeker, they want you to hang around. There's my mate Mark. We used to be in this classroom together, mate. Back in the day. Yeah, there you go. When you first visit someone, don't stay there for hours on end. They might be full of questions. Make your first visit with a person really brief, really quick. In fact, if I'm delivering a DVD or something, I say, hey, look, I can't stay. I'll drop back next week and get you the next one. Hope it works all right. It was really nice to meet you. Bang, I'm gone. I've seen so many people drop out of Bible studies because the dear saint wanted to be there for 3 hours. Who's got 3 hours? We're busy. You never are there more than an hour. And the Bible study's only taking 40 minutes and you might have a talking before, talking after, you're gone. But you do not wear people out. And particularly on your early visits, you be quick. I had a mate who a saint was studying with, and I organised it to go there, and the guy was staying for 3 hours every time he'd come for the study. They dropped out of the studies. You would think they're not interested. Another pastor came along and started with them. He stayed an hour. He baptised them. They just couldn't afford 3 hours of their life. Be brief. There's plenty of time later. Take your time, but don't take too much of their time. Answer questions through a formal set of Bible studies and use Bible study guides. Let me just talk about that quickly before we go to Christian. There's a lot of different Bible study guides available that I actually recommend that you use a formal set of Bible study guides. Why would I recommend that? Any of these Bible study guides are great. I love a question and answer one. These are Secrets of Prophecy's question and answer. They ask a question. Question number two in this one. Who does God reveal his secrets through? Where do we find the answer? Amos 3:7. We turn up Amos 3:7. I'll read the question again. Who does God reveal his secrets through? The answer comes from where? The Bible. It's a powerful method. It's a powerful method. The Bible's answering the questions. Yeah. And they get to open it up and it's got the page numbers. Use a systematic set of Bible studies. There's so many good ones, different ones of these. I love Ty Gibson's new ones, The Truth Link, Logic of Love, just because the picture they give of God is profound.
Yes, it is.
He goes out of his way to show that God is a loving God and loves the person. They're not question and answer. So they're actually a little more difficult to use than the old-fashioned question and answer. If you're just starting giving Bible studies, use a question and answer Bible study guide. It's so easy. If you can read English, you can do it. There's on your sheet, there's actually a website where you can download a free set of Bible study guides that I made that are on our website. They are Bible marking course. They're kind of set up as a question and answer, but they've been converted into a Bible marking course. So they're free. You can print those off willy-nilly, however you like. Any questions before I have a little bit of break and then we go to Christian on his stuff? Let's have a five-minute break and then we'll have a look at this new app that Christian's got for us.
Have a quick bathroom break.
You've got to do that, mate. Okay. So you're just going to go through how it all works and da 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 da.
It's up to you. I wanted to share a little bit about the concept.
I won't actually go through this handout with you this afternoon. I probably won't. We won't get time. We'll see how we go. But this is the handout we give out to our Bible workers and pastors and people that are following up a summer camp decision. Now, this could apply in different settings, but at summer camps, we'll have 200 young people make a decision and say they'd like to be baptized. And what happens next is always a big challenge because of there's a disconnection between what happened there at the camp and then when they get back to their local church, it's usually weeks later, everything else. So this little, he's an excellent little guy that, I saw Alvin somewhere, he's gone again.
He'll be back.
Alvin, he's our chaplain's coordinator, our aromantic chaplains, he gives EdSats and his chaplains too. Excellent little document on just a step-to-step guide. If a young person in your church who has made a decision at a summer camp or at any other event, how do you follow that up with them? This is a really neat little guide on how you do that. I've got plenty of them here. So, and before I kick over to Christian, Steve, who I've just met, who's a truckie working up there at the Tweed. What's it called? I always forget the name of it.
The Vine.
The Vine. The Vine. He's working with Dan Christian there and The Vine. And Steve related to some of my stories. You know, I was working in a similar industry. He's a truck driver. Steve, tell us about that one experience you had with that guy. I asked Steve that he'd share it with everyone.
Yeah, well, similar to like Justin. Our workplace is our greatest ministry. I had a similar person at work that would continually hang stuff on me. As soon as he found out I was a Christian, he was always up me. I really did not like the guy. I was wondering why every day I'd get down on my knees in the morning and ask the witness, but God kept putting this bloke in front of me. And I really didn't like him. I tolerated him and I answered questions when he said something. But, and then the second last day that I left, he walked up to me totally out of the blue and said, "Steve, I found Christ." And just weeping, and out of the blue, I didn't even know he had nothing to do with Christ or anything. He had himself a New Testament. He was reading through it. He was obviously having convictions. But, yeah, it's amazing how God can work.
It happens a lot.
Had nothing to do with it.
It happens a lot. People that have a reaction is always good. People that never react, not much you can do, but a reaction. And sometimes it's really, you preach a sermon and you get to the door and they tear strips off you. I remember one lady once at Port Macquarie, she got me at the door and absolutely demolished me. And you're very vulnerable right after your sermon. You go, that must have been bad. But 2 days later, she came to me and told me God had been speaking to her. And she didn't want to do what he'd asked her to do. And I didn't know he was using me in the sermon. I was like, oh, sorry. But it was God who had used this donkey to be able to communicate with that lady that day. And they would have had something going on between them that I was like, oh, I don't know. I didn't know that. I hadn't even said what she thought I said. But she heard it because God wanted her to hear it.
That's right.
And that's why God can use donkeys. You just got to be open to be used and have the courage to go out and be used. Now, one thing that we are toying with, we're getting set up because we believe our potential to generate new interest is about to go through the roof with these TV ministries. And as we get radio more online as well and start to advertise and promote it, how we manage all that, our summer camp contacts, if I'm really honest with you, we struggle.
So much.
We struggle to manage them, the massive amounts of numbers, and we usually get them, will come through to like Avondale School. How many album was it, like 80? Young, I can't remember.
60 or 80.
60 or 80 or something. All at once, you try and follow up that many young people at once. You don't have enough hours in your week. And the poor chaplains are just like, it's like you just throw them in the water and say swim. We're trying to develop systems so we can make sure none of those young people who make that decision are lost. And we want this to work as well with our TV. And if we can set up a team across our conference of ambassadors, it would be awesome if we could get them on this app and we can use this app as their ways of getting the contacts and following them up. So, Christian, why don't you take us through it, mate? You can take it from here and I'll sit and listen.
Thank you, Justin. I'm glad you mentioned summer camps. Just yesterday, I was talking to a gentleman in a place far, far away from here, so it doesn't relate to anything that happens in this conference. And he was telling me that his two teenage sons, had attended summer camp. It'd been about a month now, and he was really excited because both of them had come home letting their parents know they'd put on a decision card that they wanted to get baptized. And the father was very excited. And I said, well, how's that going? What's happened? Where are they at now? He said, well, it's been about a month now, and they're still waiting. They haven't heard back from anyone yet. I asked the local church pastor, and he said he wasn't sure what was happening with them, so we'll wait a little bit more and see what happens. Now, anyone that's had children, or if you remember what it was like when you were in your teens and you make a decision, every day that lapses makes a difference in your enthusiasm and your excitement to be able to follow through on that decision. When I arrived at a church a few years ago, the church clerk gave me a stack of papers and I asked her what they were and what I needed to do with them. And she said, well, I don't know. They've just been passed on to me from the previous clerk and they're for you. And I had a look. They were different contacts that had come through from Try Jesus cards, from Beyond videos, from all sorts of different things that had been sent to the church. And I asked her, who's been following these up? We were going back 3 to 4 years of contact. And she said, nobody. And wanting to reach as many people in the community, I started going through. I didn't get a single person after 3-4 years. A lot of them had moved on. Most of them didn't even remember sending anything in. When people are searching, when people are responding to the Holy Spirit's conviction, what a privilege and an honor to be able to interact and engage with them as soon as possible. I'm reminded by something that's both in the Bible and in the spirit of prophecy, and it's a statement that the shepherd leaves the flock in the safety of the pen and he goes after the one that is lost. In the spirit of prophecy, we're told that Christ would have come to die for one. So when we have one of those names on a decision card at a summer camp, one of our own young people, when we have someone in the community that we spend tens of thousands of dollars to reach, and they respond,
they have the courage. They listen to that conviction of the Holy Spirit and they pick up the phone or they fill out a card and they send it in. That is one person that Christ would have emptied heaven for. And in fact, he did. He came down. That is one person. If only that one person was here, Jesus would have still come. How valuable for us to be able to follow up effectively when they've made that decision instead of leaving it even a month. A month may already be too long for some people. You know, there is only one reason why you and I are alive. We're either lost, and I pray that for all of us in this room that's not the case, or we still have a mission to do. There's still something for us to do. Wouldn't it be easier to just now while I'm talking because you've had a wonderful lunch, close your eyes, and the very next thing you see is Jesus coming back? Wouldn't that be easy? Wouldn't that be wonderful? Don't close your eyes. Don't try this right now, okay? That would be much easier. And I'm sure God loves us so much, they would much rather take us as soon as we've given our lives to him. But he says there's still a purpose for you. There's a mission. You are only alive because I want you to be an instrument in my hands. How can we make sure that we can be effective instruments? Now, there's a particular challenge with follow-up. And one of the issues I want to clarify from the very beginning, we are not looking at casting blame. That is not the purpose of what we're about to discuss today. It's not the member, the elder, the deacon, the pastor. It's not Justin. It's not an individual's fault that we are trying to identify. But the question is, what are the issues? What are the challenges? And how can we together support each other, pastors, churches, conference administrators, Bible workers, lay people, elders, deacons, members, how can we overcome some of the challenges that we face? Time is definitely an obvious one for many people. You might get, as Justin just mentioned, 80 names. How do you fit 80 names into the schedule of one person throughout the week? Sometimes, especially when it comes to ministry or elders, there are significant issues at a local church. They might be issues that could easily be resolved. Sometimes the church burned down. Sometimes there are internal conflicts. Sometimes there are a lot of people that are sick or unwell. All sorts of things that prevent pastors, elders, leaders to follow up effectively. Sometimes it could be that the church isn't in a place, whether because it doesn't have ability, that's not its main focus, or it doesn't understand its focus, or it doesn't have the adequate training to follow up. And I'm glad we've got this leadership weekend to address the ability for each and every one of us to interact with those who have put their hand up, that they want some help, they want to be led to Jesus. Sometimes it's a personal thing. Sometimes it could be whether it's ministers, elders, whatever. We're going through our own personal struggles. And sometimes, because of the challenges we're experiencing, and that's life, I've had some ups and downs, and I'm sure all of us can put up our hands and say, yes, we've had ups and downs. But because I'm going through a difficult place, should we as a church corporately allow people who have asked, these are not people we're searching for, they have contacted us, they're saying, help me, because I'm struggling, should the church just drop the ball? Or is there another way, a more effective way, that we together can support each other and make sure that we engage with those that have put their hand up and said, I want to know Jesus? How can we support each other? What we're about to look at is exactly this. What can we do together, corporately, as a family, to make sure that each and every single name, whether it's a teen camp or a summer camp, whether it's your local church sermon and the pastor has made an appeal and there's some decision cards, whether it's a 3ABN contact, a Faith FM contact, and it is written contact, whatever way people contact us, how can we work together to make sure that each one of these names is followed up efficiently and effectively? We've been working on something that is not revolutionary. It's very simple, it's very basic, and it's something that most pastors, dare I say, every single pastor is already doing, many churches are already doing, elders sometimes are doing this as well. So what we're about to look at, remember, is not new. But it's a more effective way so that what we are doing individually can work together corporately to make sure that no single person is the only link between a contact and coming to know Jesus. We've called it 4-1 because Jesus came and died, even if it was only 4-1. And we want the name to reflect our focus. This really is about that one person. It's not about me. It's not about saying, you know, I'm not effective, I'm not doing a good job, I'm not doing well enough. But it's saying, how can we support myself, yourself, each other to follow up this one person? Now, I'm not sure if you've noticed, I'm repeating myself a lot. Have you noticed that? Because every time we talk about being more effective, there's always a little bit of concern that we're talking about micromanaging or about being too involved in what other people are doing in their work. Let me do my job, you do your job. And that's fair enough to a degree, except for when people's eternal lives are at stake. When eternal lives are at stake, we're in this together. We're a family, we work together, we support each other, we pray together, and we work for every single one. I'd like to give you a little bit of an overview of the app that I'm going to show you briefly. And these are four main aims for moving in this direction, trialing this, and hopefully making this an effective way of following up. It's going to provide a tool that pastors, elders, and I should say members, anyone can use. Quite simply, if you've got a mobile phone and you know how to use your average smartphone, you'll be able to use this. There is a little bit of a learning curve, but every time you buy a bit of technology, it takes a few minutes to learn. And that's about all it's going to take, a few minutes, not too much longer. We're also going to be able to address when there are issues, when there are challenges, when there's an obstacle. And remember, the obstacles that we're looking at is not to cast blame, not to identify a person and say, you're not doing a good job, you're out, you're in, pick up your game. But it's saying, what are the challenges? None of us wake up in the morning and say, you know what? I'm a Seventh-day Adventist minister, I'm an elder, I'm a deacon, and I don't care about anyone else in the world. All of us want to help. All of us have a desire to reach people. We wouldn't be here otherwise, would we? You know, I can think of some lay activities, quite horizontal, that are much more enticing on a Sabbath afternoon than sitting here in a lecture theatre, right? But we're here because we are passionate about reaching people. Sometimes there are challenges in reaching or contacting those who have requested help, support, Bible studies, visitation. What is it? What are those challenges? How can we together, as a conference, as local churches, as ministers, as elders, as deacons, all of us together, how can we support, train, make sure that a person is not left behind, they don't slip through the cracks. One of the other challenges we sometimes face is when there's a change in leadership, a change in pastor. Every year we have new nominating committees. Some churches do it biannually. And sometimes names get lost during that transition. New pastor, new team, a new leadership. Sometimes we can forget people. How can we make sure that that doesn't happen? And also, there are some pastors, some elders, some churches that are brilliant at following up. They are. And they might feel, you know, I don't need anything like this. We're doing a fantastic job without any extra help, without any app, without any insights. You may not need it, but we need your input. We need your insights. We need your help. We would like to see what you are doing. What is working? What's effective? What are you doing in your area as a pastor, as an elder, as a deacon, as a personal ministries director, leader? What are you doing that's working so well? Can we learn from you? Can you share with others? And we don't have as much collaboration between our churches as we probably could to be able to learn from each other, grow. You know, I remember doing a quit smoking program or a health program, and every time I started a new program, it was really me starting from scratch. So much better if I could talk to three or four other churches who have done it. How did it go? What did you do? What worked? What didn't work? I think it'd be far more effective and efficient in terms of our time, our resources and energy than simply every single church reinventing the wheel from scratch. And if something hasn't worked, I'd like to know so I don't do what you did and what didn't work for you. And vice versa. Didn't work for me. I tried this. Don't do this. Or at least you can learn from my mistakes and maybe try to do something a little bit differently. The app collects some information from people. Now, the reason I say it's not revolutionary is because all of this information we already have. Now, some pastors, and you know them if they go to your church, they have a photographic memory, right? They don't need an iPhone or a tablet or a spreadsheet or a notebook. They just remember names, they remember faces. They can tell you who they studied with October 29, 1973, where they were, who they studied with, and what the study was about. It doesn't happen to most of us. Most of us are not like that. So we use notebooks, we use Excel spreadsheets, we use pieces of paper, we use petrol receipts. I've seen members every now and again write them, you know, on their hand. I just hope you don't have a shower too often. So we're already collecting personal details, name, address, just basic details that people are giving us. Some people have a concern about privacy. We're not getting anything new here. We're not digging into people's lives and adding them to a database to be followed up when they haven't asked for it. These are people who are saying, here's my name, here's my information, I want someone to study with me, I want to be visited. Personal details. Then we're also keeping a more accurate track of the engagement method. What was the first thing that led them to make contact with us? Why do you think something like this might be useful for us as a church family? Target our resources, yeah. If we know.
See what's effective, what's working the best.
Absolutely.
And understand their gifts to be able to use them in the church.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's find out how a person has responded to the gospel, to the messages we've given. Are we finding that we're spending, you know, millions of dollars on this particular initiative, but when we look down the track, it hasn't really been effective long term? Could it be that there's a church here and every time they have a new contact, it just says friendship, and they're reaching dozens of people with only six church members, and they're doing something simple, free, and very effective? Can we learn from them? This will be incredibly effective for us to be able to know how to best use our resources and how to learn from each other as well. Contact status, we want to know if a person is actively interested, if they've gone on holidays, and why might that be important? When a new pastor comes in, when someone goes on holidays, let's know what's still happening with these contacts. You know, I'm on long service leave for 3 months. What happens with my Bible studies? Hope for the best, you know. I've taught them how to pray, and what else is there? They can receive wisdom from on high. Then we want to be able to know where they are at in their Bible study. What study are they up to? So that way, when I pass on that Bible study student to somebody else, they know exactly where they left off. I've gone to many churches where I've come in, and sometimes I was actually given a name of people to follow up. What have you been studying with them? The pastor's gone, he's moved overseas, he doesn't remember. I go every single time and I'm starting from scratch. That can also tell us what Bible studies are effective. Is there a trend? Are we losing people at a particular set of studies or a particular topic in the series? When I go next week, it's been a hectic week, a lot of stress, I've had family issues, whatever. I turn up to my Bible student and they open their Bibles and they're excited and they're waiting for me, and I ask them the obvious question. Now, where were we again? And it's good when they remember, but it's really bad when they don't know either. Well, this is a way for us to track to know. I'm studying with 20 people. Instead of having to try to memorize or put notes on my hands or on post-it notes, I know exactly where we're up to with them. Secondary support or a secondary disciple maker. As a church, we have struggled to be able to teach or disciple others in giving Bible studies, in reaching out to others. There's a field there or an opportunity for every Bible study contact that I have to invite somebody else with me. So straight away, if I'm sick, if I'm not available, if someone else needs to come in and take over, we know who the second person that has been coming with me is. It also encourages us, whether we're pastors, elders, members, Bible workers, it encourages us to start thinking in twos. We are fantastic at thinking in ones. When Jesus sent them out, he did not send them out in ones. He sent them out in twos. And there's a lot of good reasons for that. Your own personal safety is sometimes a good reason, depending on who you're studying with, but especially to be able to train, to develop, to help others know how to share the Bible. If you're very effective at it, please bring somebody else with you. Show them how to do that, let them learn, and then in time give them other contacts to follow up, which will make it easier for everybody, especially when you're dealing with 80 contacts or so. And then, of course, you've got the opportunity to hand over names, pass them on to the new pastor or to another member or elder or somebody else that is going to be following up with them. This is just a little bit of a spider web of how the data looks. It's not that complicated when you access it, but just a lot of links that gives you a little bit of an idea of what's happening behind. How does a support mechanism work to make sure that we don't lose a name, that we don't let someone slip through the cracks? This is going to be available for both pastors, elders, members, those who are involved in sharing the Bible, in visiting, in taking a resource. It's not just Bible studies, whether you're giving a Bible study or a resource or prayer or social visit, this can be used. Now, when a new name is entered into the application, into 4-1, that name goes to a green status for 2 weeks. For 2 weeks, that name is green, and that gives me, it gives you an opportunity to visit that person, to make contact with them over a 2-week period. Do you think that's adequate? That's enough? Too short? Too long? In my opinion, I wouldn't let it go for more than 2 weeks. If someone said, I want to be baptized, and I'm waiting for 3 weeks to make contact with them, we're already losing a little bit of the enthusiasm, and they may even feel that we don't really care. You know, I want to go to heaven. That's okay. You know, I'm a little busy right now. You can wait for 3-4 weeks. So that name goes to green. Now, the names can be inserted into this app by yourself. You can enter it when you meet someone on the doors, someone that comes to your church or a program. When it is written as an event or it is written as a program, the names will automatically be inserted and delegated to somebody. So no names will ever sit on a stationary database. They're not going to be in the cloud or in the system. That will be impossible. There is no such thing as a system administrator that receives names. Are you with me? The name is given to somebody, to a person, to a human being. It goes into their phone. So when they open the app on their phone, they'll get a little bell or a little notification that says you've got a new contact. It will not sit static on the shelf. For 2 weeks, that name will be green. And if it's followed up, within 2 weeks, every single time, that name will continue to remain green. If the person isn't interested, you've got the option to select, you know, inactive or moved on or stopped. So there are things that you can do once you're followed up, depending on how the person responds. I'll take you through the app shortly as well. After 2 weeks, if that name hasn't been followed up, 4-1 will automatically send a note, a reminder, an email, it depends on your context, an SMS, whatever works with you in your context, to your ministry support partner. How many of you have a ministry support partner? Your wife, a Bible worker. And that's one of the challenges in ministry, isn't it? It's a hand solo approach. It's a 1-by-1 instead of a 2-by-2. And we want to encourage each and every person that studies the Bible with somebody else to have a ministry partner. Who's praying for you when you're giving a Bible study? You can't be praying for yourself when you're doing the talking. It's a little bit hard. I've tried. I get confused. Who supports you? Who keeps you in prayer? It could be your wife. It could be your elder. It could be the conference president. It could be somebody in the church, a Seventh-day Adventist that prays for you, that cares for you. And in 2 weeks, that if you haven't had the chance to follow up, they're going to get a little note, and it reminds them to give you a call, to send you a message, to give you a hug and say, can I support you? Can I help you? Can I follow up this contact? Is there something that's preventing you from being able to help this person that has said, I want to know Jesus? You with me so far?
Yep.
Does that make sense? Is that clear enough? Yeah? Very, very simple. We're hoping to make this as simple as possible so that I can get the hang of it too. At 3 weeks, so this is at 21 days, at 15 days, your ministry partner, and you select this ministry partner. You identify who it is that your ministry partner is and who's going to get that. At 3 weeks, so this is at 22 days, there's a note that goes to the area mentor for that particular region. We have district pastors in our conference, and he'll get a short note, and that note will simply say there's a contact, there's a person here who's shouted for help, they're drowning, they're sinking, they've said, help me up, and for whatever reason, we haven't had the opportunity to follow them up. This is not about pointing a finger at anybody, but identifying. Remember who this is about? For the one person. What can we do for them? The area mentor can talk with the pastor, who may talk with the elder or the member. It could be that the pastor has some family issues, pastor's in hospital, the pastor's on holidays, the elder has the same or a member. Whatever the issue is, what is it? What can we do? How can we support? How can we resource? And at 4 weeks, there's a note that goes to Pastor Neil Thompson, our ministerial secretary, and that's just another small alert. Now, he's not going to get very many names. He's not going to get very many alerts, because most of us, within 2 weeks, will be able to follow up somebody. But if at 1 month, we're talking about 29 days, a local leader, a pastor, an elder, a church member, a Bible worker, anybody looking after that name, after 1 month, after a prayer, support, encouragement, an offer for help from their ministry partner, after the interaction from the regional mentor, the district pastor, if we still haven't been able to support this one person that has said, give me Jesus, then we as a conference, we as a family, administrators, pastors, members need to say, what can we do? What's the issue? What's the best way we can support this one person and those others who are there to support them who may be struggling, there may be challenges, we don't know what they are. We can find out, what can we do for you? Could it be that we've had 80 names and there's one pastor and three members at that church. Could that be the reason? It's going to be impossible to follow up. What can we do? Well, maybe we can send some Bible workers there. We can send the A-team for 3 to 4 months to be able to support with all these follow-ups. Maybe we need to put another pastor or an intern. Maybe the challenge is so big that we're going to send an email to everybody in the conference and say, we cannot handle the amount of people that are asking for Bible studies. Are there any church members who can take a few months off, 2 months, 3 months, we'll provide accommodation, come on in, at least let's follow up these people. Are you with me so far? Can you see the value, the benefit? Whatever it is, how can we support this one person? And then obviously, if you visited a person and they've said, no, I'm not interested, or they said, I'd like to stop, or I'd like a holiday, it goes to inactive and then there's no follow-up. There's no email, there's no reminder, there's no note, because that can often happen as well. I visited with people and they've said, I'm not interested any longer, I don't want any more DVDs, I need some time to reflect on what I've studied, or it's too much for me right now. But the advantage is you've still got that information there. Next time you run an evangelistic campaign and they may turn up again, you can quickly look up through your database, and this is not illegal, this is within the privacy laws, we can keep data for so many years, and see, hey, have we worked with this person before? When a new pastor comes in, there's a few inactive names, but all of a sudden somebody turns up to church and I just check, is this someone we've met before? Oh, yes, it is. The previous pastor studied, they got to State of the Dead, and then something went wrong. We'll be doing some cemetery visits if Pastor Bob Mann is here. We know that they got up to here and they come back to church and we can ask them, you know, I know you studied with the previous pastor, could have been 3 years ago, and I know you did some Bible studies. Is it something we could resume? Do you have some questions? Whatever the issue might be. But it makes it really easy for us to be able to follow up and restart contact with people who may come for a little bit and then leave and then we lose track of what's been happening with them. The app is also going to continue to be developed. We've already started on the next two sections. You can already start to record small group attendance. So if you're running a small group, you can keep a track of who's there, who's not there, so you know who to visit, who to ring, who to pray for, who to follow up if they haven't been able to make it. The church participation thing, we can already track church attendance if you'd like to do that with seekers or members, a simpler, quicker, easier way to do that. And we're going to work on a couple of other modules to ensure that this isn't the end of what we're doing, but just the beginning to help us keep a track and make sure we know how effective we are and where people are at and make sure that they're not being left behind. Just a few short benefits, and then I'm going to put the phone in and take you for a little bit of a demo through it. Without having to send an email or a letter or a phone call or a smoke signal or however we communicate wherever we might be, you can forward a name onto somebody that's more appropriate to follow them up. So you might say, you know, you could be the pastor in a local area, you've got a lot of names, straight away that name comes to you, you can send it to one of the elders, and in that elders app, there's a little note, it says you've got a contact. And they've got 2 weeks to be able to interact with that person. When a pastor moves on, when an elder moves on, a nominating committee has chosen another team, instantly all the names of the previous person can be transferred to somebody else.
So if you're studying with somebody and you've got to whatever, State of the Dead or whatever, mm-hmm. and then they say, oh, look, I've got a family, I'm moving to so-and-so,
mm-hmm.
you can then put their name into that
mm-hmm.
and that means that they will be followed up when they get down to Melbourne or Victoria or whatever.
Well, what happens to that name as this system expands and other conferences are starting to look into using it as well, you just select the name of the pastor or the elder, or you make contact with that church, find out who can look after them, select the name from the app, and all the information, where you've studied, how they came to your church, everything is now in the inbox of that new person, and the name is green for 2 weeks for them to be able to follow up with them when they move down to the area. Yeah. It's not going back into an admin. You cannot send a name back to the office. It's not sitting on a shelf somewhere. It is always a person that will be able to look after it. Miroslav.
I can understand pastors then, if they don't follow up, the name goes up further to the area manager,
mm-hmm.
the ministerial secretary. What about church members who are not following up? Where does their name go?
Their process will start with the local pastor. So it will go their ministry partner, their local pastor, and then the area mentor, and then the ministerial secretary. And again, the reason and the purpose is we are in this together. And the office is not here to dictate or to give commands and orders, but to support. And if a group of church members are not able to handle the contacts that have come in their way, what can we do to support? What are the issues? What are the needs? Is it training? Is it time? Is it resources? What is it? What can we do? Because this is why we're here. We're not here for the buildings. We're not here for the programs. We're not here for the events. We're here for people. People, people, people. That's the only reason. How else can we support these people? How can we make sure they're being supported? As I said, I don't think Neil will get too many names, because generally, whether it's the pastor, the regional pastor, or somebody else, we'll be able to follow up much earlier in the process. But if we find that because of too much work or internal issues or whatever it is, there are some challenges, the conference has an opportunity to be able to support as well. Resourcing, staffing, money, whatever the issue might be. How can we make sure that that one person, it's already been a month by the time it's gone to Neil, 1 month that a person has asked for help and we haven't had an opportunity to interact with them. Peter.
Chris, how will you determine who that contact is to be sent? Will that be via a postcode or something? Because like if you go up to the Northern Rivers area, there's a lot of churches close.
Sure.
And the name could be sent to the Kingsford pastor, but they're actually going to Wollumbar. How will you work out who that's sent?
Every church has a coverage area. And the name will go to basically based on the address. Now, it could be that the person might be sent to you, and even though they live in your coverage area, they're going to another church. You can put a little note on them, and I'll show you a little bit further about that. You could send the name back to another person. So it's not going to be a shelf or a static space. It may go back to whoever sent it to you, who is also a Seventh-day Adventist, who's also caring for names, and put a note and say, this person is attending this church. Straight away, that note goes there, there's a flag, and the name can be reallocated to the correct person, but generally by postcode.
So, Christian, when that begins to take place, so suppose Peter just says, well, actually, it's not his church, it's Neil's church, so then he puts it to me.
Mm-hmm.
Pete might have been sitting on that for a week before he got around to looking at that and sending it to me.
Mm-hmm.
Do I now have a week to respond to that, or do I have 2 weeks?
No, it's a very good question.
Yeah.
But I think it will be most effective if you will have 2 weeks, and we've said 2 weeks because you may be running an evangelistic campaign, you may be visiting 20 people already and studying with 30, and 2 weeks gives you an opportunity to delegate it to an elder. I know it will stretch the time a little bit, but I think it will be more effective and fairer for everybody rather than, you know, somebody gave me a name at 14 days, and at 15 days there's an alert or a note or an email because I haven't followed up. And we're not going to be playing ping pong with names. None of us are in that business. You know, we're not here to say, well, let's keep passing the buck from there to there. All of us are here because we care, right?
Yep.
That's our reason. That's why you're here this afternoon. That's why we're in ministry. Pastors don't go into ministry because it's a great job. The benefits are fantastic and the salary is huge. I can go back and do a trade and make 4 times as much in a trade as a laborer instead of doing ministry. I'm not here because the money is fantastic and wonderful. I know all the pastors I know are there for the same reason. So it's not about bouncing the name, but how can we follow up most effectively? I've got a question at the back, one there, Rebecca, and then one at the front. At the back, please. We'll go with you. I can hear him easier. There are. There's a comment section where you can add extra details. Why this person made the decision, any family issues, anything you need to support. You can add comments and you can create notes on the name, so the notes are based on the date you've created them. So extra things that will help you remember where that person's at.
Christian, we probably should get to the app, just looking at time.
2 more questions and then we'll get to the app. That's a good point, Neil. Rebecca and then...
Just a couple of points. I'm just curious. Just legally with privacy issues, because we're recording a lot of persons with information about people.
That's a really good question. We're only entering the information that they're giving us.
That's going to a lot of people that they
know. That information will only go initially to the person that they've given the information to.
Yeah.
If I pass that information on to somebody else, and we do this on paper already, so this isn't anything different, but if I'm passing the details on to somebody else, I will ring you up and I'll say, Beck, I'm sharing a contact with you. I will also let my contact know before I let you know.
Yeah.
Is it okay if I pass you on to Beck? Beck will be looking after you. I've moved out of the area. Beck is someone who's more appropriate. It wouldn't be just, you know. Absolutely, yeah. That's right. So we're not doing anything different to what we're doing on paper. All we're doing is we're looking at how to make this more effective. One more question.
Yeah, another geographical sort of one. You know, I'm living in Norway, so I get something turns up in my, somebody out in Bungandai, 120 k away to visit.
Yeah.
It may be a little tricky to get there in 2 weeks.
And that's a really good point. Let's say you say there is no way I can get there in 2 weeks. Is it an area where we're getting a number of contacts that we could add a Bible worker in that region? You know, could we get a Bible worker that might not be as busy for the next 2-3 weeks to at least start making contact with that person? What's the solution? We're working together. It's not about saying, I can't believe you didn't follow up. You really should be following up. Why aren't you following up? Or a phone call. The app also tracks phone calls. So you can, when you ring that person, if they've given you their phone number, you enter when the phone call has been made. And that will give you your next 2 weeks to be able to say, I've contacted the person, I've let them know, I've heard their invitation, I'm going to be back there in 2-3 weeks when I can. There will be a few teething issues as we learn and grow through this. You can imagine the scope and the size of it. And there will be some things that we had anticipated, some problems, some issues that we haven't thought of. All feedback is welcome. We'll learn, we'll keep improving. This is not designed to make anybody's life difficult, but to make sure that we don't lose that one person. For one, keep that in mind. One final question, and then while I plug this in.
I was just thinking, if you had multiple Bible study requests come in, can it be done via phone? Like, email the questions through and then do it via phone?
I think there are people who have far more experience than me to answer that as well. In my perspective, the personal interaction with somebody is the key to being able to support them, to understand them. You can read their facial expressions. You can understand what the challenges or struggles they are. Even Skype, and I was at a church that did a lot of Skype Bible studies, even that wasn't as effective as the personal interaction. If we cannot get somebody there within 2 weeks, what can we do as a church family? How can we solve this issue? What is it going to take to get someone there within 2 weeks of somebody making a decision? Does that sound about right, Justin?
Yes. Look, doing a Bible study over the phone, it's been done, I've done it myself, and you do what you have to do, but it's less than ideal. And it wouldn't be something you want to do all the time. And you can visit with someone over the phone, or you can go and sit down in their lounge room, and that, you know, depending on the person and the situation. But a Bible study for a new person, you really need to be doing it there with them. That's ideal. But do what you have to do.
I'm just going to give you a snapshot. There are a few things that the developers are still updating, and they've been working on it furiously. We've been very demanding and kept on asking them to add extra things that we hadn't thought of as we're learning in the process as well. When you open the app, this is what it looks like. Generally, a few minor changes in time. You can see your calendar. You can link it in with your iCal, your Outlook, anything else that you're using so that your appointments can come up straight there, what's on for today. You can see a list of your recent interactions. There's a couple of things there. There's a visit to Mandy, and there's two contacts that I was able to have a look at. If I click on Mandy, she's somebody who I've recently made contact with. You can see that the primary support, that's me. I'm the person that's caring for this name. They're affiliated with a school as well. So while they attend a church, we know that this person is affiliated with a school. It could be a retirement village, it could be a nursing home, it could be sanitarium. Do they have another link? And that's helpful, especially when we're talking with or about students. Secondary support, I don't have anybody with me. And that's something that I need to start thinking about. Who can I take with me as I visit Mandy? Possibly another female that can relate to her, somebody that can learn how I share the Bible, and that can possibly take this Bible study on, or at least another. You've got the gender there, especially some ethnic names are a little difficult to know the gender. And if a name comes into you from it is written or somewhere else, would like them, if possible, to identify. Are you expecting to visit male or female, so we know who the best person to visit? Their birthday, only if they give you that information. It may be helpful to send them a little card, an SMS, a reminder on their birthdays. Mobile, the church that they're attending or the church that they're affiliated with because of the region. So they might not be attending church, but they go to Peter's church, and we're going to have that as the primary church that they are associated or affiliated with. Here we've got engagement. How do we get to know this person? Well, they came through a community needs program. That's one of the main categories. They went to something to do with health. And what wasn't? We've got the comments box there. You can add whatever you want in the comments box where it says engagement comments. This person came to a depression recovery program. We've got their address. We've got a map that you can click on, and it will automatically give you GPS directions to know how to get there. And it's telling me that it's been, I'm still within the 14 days of my last visit, because my last visit was 6th of the 2nd. It was a very recent visit. My first visit was also on 6th of the 2nd. So I have an idea of when I started visiting with this person and the last time that I was there. And it will also have a field that lets you know the anticipated next visit. And you can set that to weekly or fortnightly, depending on your context as well. Is that part clear on what a general contact looks like before I move on? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, if I click here, this has my menu.
Christian, just as you go through, just say which section you're clicking. You can't see.
Okay. Now, there will be specific training in churches and in regions to use this app. So don't feel like you have to memorize everything today. This is just a demo, an overview, and then we'll make sure that before anybody uses it, we'll have some one-on-one time, some interaction, some groups to ask any questions and iron out any bugs. Let's say I click on a new visit up there on the screen. I clicked on visits, actually not new visit. This gives me the opportunity to enter a new visit when I've started following up with somebody. It asks me a few very basic details. Who is it that I'm visiting? I can type in the name and it will start to give me a list of all the names that I'm working with, or I can click the magnifying glass and it'll give me a list of everybody as well, so that I can just scroll through quickly as well. I can see the names there. These names will show up a little bit bigger. They're not quite that small when you're using it. I've clicked in Alison Young. I've got the date there. I can modify the date, and this is where I can put my categories in. So if you see down the bottom, it gives me a couple of options. Is this a social visit? Am I delivering a resource? Am I just there to support them? They're going through a time of grief. There's someone from the community who's had a loss in the family, and I'm there to pray with them. Is it a Bible study? Is it a follow-up on something else? Or could it be that I have turned up to their door, but they're not available? That will track it, and that will reset that two-week period. Hopefully, you'll be able to catch up with them earlier, but if you're driving 120 kilometers and they said they'd be home and they weren't home, it's unlikely that you can get there the very next morning. So let's say a Bible study to give you an idea of how that works. Let's say it's a Bible study visit that I'm going on. Then it gives me a few more options. What kind of Bible studies? Is it a baptismal study? Supplementary? These are some key topics that may not be necessary for baptism, but that we'd like to study with people who have an interest. Is it a special interest? You know, we're studying through, but they've got a really odd question about what happens to marriage in heaven, and this is a major issue for them, so we're going to study this. You put special interest, and then you list what that study is. If I went to baptismal, it will bring up another category there. If I click on that, all of a sudden I've got a list of the general recommended Bible study topics in a relatively good order for studying with someone preparing them for baptism. So I've pressed done on that, and then I hit the save button, and that visit has been logged. I know what I've done, when I've done it, and it's given me all the details there. If I go back to my main menu, and again, as I said, I'm just racing through a few of the ideas to give you a bit of an overview. You won't have all these buttons. You can see there, this is a list of my visits in order of time, who I visited in the last little while. And aside from visiting somebody and entering their contact details, that's about all there is to it. There are some other things that we'll do in the training. How do I delegate a contact? I won't show you that because that's not the focus of what we're doing. You can add a little note, and you can add or send the note to another user. Let's say Justin and I are starting with a contact, and I'm away for a few days, but the contact has asked for a Bible. When I visit, I can add a little note by Bible, and I can delegate that note or that task to Justin. And on Justin's phone, there'll be a little note linked to that contact that says, buy a Bible for Allison by the next Bible study, or a date or week, month, whatever it is. You can leave a comment for the next person that's studying. So there are a lot of other features that will make it more effective to be able to interact and share. But in its very simplest form, add a new contact, mention that you visited them, and that will be able to track what you're doing. I think I had a question there first, and then Darren.
I'm just wondering if you use cloud storage, because if you drop your phone in the water and it dies, if all the information disappears, all of a sudden you're lost.
So this app will be secure. You can enter a password every time. If you do have a phone password, then you don't need to enter a password. You can select that, but it is all in the cloud. So if you've lost your iPhone, if you're doing it on a tablet, there is a desktop version. If you're at home and you want to enter a lot of contacts quickly, instead of sitting there, you know, if you're like me and you're not very quick with the thumbs, you can import contacts from Excel. You can import them from other applications. If you've got 20 contacts you're already working with, they're in a spreadsheet, import them right in. You don't have to go through, add each name individually. They're all in the cloud, you'll never lose them. Darren.
Yeah, I was just gonna ask, can you, like, can you search every contact in the conference, or is it just...
No, you can only search the contacts that have been allocated to you. So for privacy reasons, people who have been allocated to you that have given permission for you to receive their name. Now, when a person requests something, let's say from it is written, they are giving us as a church permission to follow up that name, and that permission is then being given to somebody at the local level, me, you, somebody else. We have the legal right to do that, and as I said, contact them before you pass the name on to somebody else.
What stops the local Mormon pastor downloading the app and go,
know who the contacts are? Hopefully a few big, strong guys. You'll have your own username and password. You'll have your own your account. That's how we delegate names. Pastors, elders, members will be able to each log in individually. So there's no crossover of contact. There's no confusion like that. Absolutely. They're linked to a specific account.
Christian, this isn't available on the App Store, is it?
It is available on the App Store, but you need to be a user to be able to use it. And you're a user after you've gone through the training and we assign you a username and password. When we assign you a username and a password, during the training, you'll be able to go through it, ask any questions. We can assign contacts to you.
Is it called 411 on the App Store?
It won't be called 411. The system that we're using is called Salesforce, and people have asked why we're using them. They're the number one leader in user contact management, data management. They update their app every second day. We looked at 6 different possible options for this. This was not only the cheapest, but the best supported and the most powerful tool that is there on the market. They're the Apple of data management on mobile devices and on desktops.
So you're mentioning a lot about Apple and the App Store. Is this going to be an Android app as well?
For those of you that unfortunately are still on Android and haven't seen the light side yet, it will be available on. It is available on Android as well. Salesforce are international. They're global. Windows, Apple, Android, it will work on there. On Apple Watch, Salesforce do have an app. I haven't used it on the Apple Watch, but we can definitely ask them to give us a demo on how that works.
Does it have the facility to, say, generate a report? Like, say, if you wanted to share it with the elders team and say, OK, these are my visits, have a look at across the board?
Absolutely. The reporting capabilities are close to infinite. You've got the information. There are infinite ways how you can use that information to share it. When doing that, the only caveat I would say, and we're going to work through how the reports are designed, we'll create some pre-made reports that you can use, but privacy is going to be an issue. So we want to make sure that when reports are generated, it doesn't show specific names and details. It might show information. So 20 visits, 13 names, 10 coming from health, rather than this person said this at this Bible study. That's really individual data that we don't want in a general report. Alvin. Yes.
Where you can just click on one thing, mm-hmm. and then all the, you know, then that all the members of that group had that study and which study it was on that.
Absolutely. Page. It's called the small group section. You create a small group, you add your contacts to that small group, and every time you have a visit, and that's already on there, but time won't permit us to go into detail, you select the group, you enter the date, and you can make a comment. We studied this, and it brings you a list of all your users. Tick box, tick, tick, tick. They're here, they're not here, and so on. Now, those tick boxes will also link back to the individual contact. So if you go back to the contact, you can see which Bible studies, group studies they attended, which ones they missed. So you can track up and make sure you follow up, give them a study that they've missed.
Just
So that's already built into it, the small group section. Thank you, Justin.
We're going to do a lot of training here, guys, and we've got to experiment to see how we go. Our Arise class is going through right now. They're just starting on Monday. We hope to get all those guys, the Bible workers, moving forward in the future using it. We'll get a lot of feedback from them. We've got different pastors already on it and wanting to use it. We'll just, forget the app for a minute. If you have to ask, why is the Seventh-day Adventist Church on earth? Why are we here? This stuff is somewhere close to the epicenter of that. This is why we're here. We've got to become the best at this. The best organization at this, that we don't miss anyone. And hopefully this sort of tool can be a big help in doing that. But a lot of this is culture as well. I've got to say, as a pastor, I never had anything like this, and nor did I need it. I hunted them down. That's all I cared about. And I know we've got pastors like that right now. They're all over this. This is like obsolete to them. But others don't necessarily, they're caught up in lots of other activities. We need to know so we can make sure we've got resource there. And no one gets missed. Because we know right now, we're missing a lot of people every year. They're not being followed up. And as Christian said, this isn't about blaming people or anything. It's about fixing that. So that doesn't happen.
They're falling through the cracks.
They're falling through the cracks. No one means to. But the sheer numbers in our schools, you'll have a week of spiritual emphasis, Alvin. It's not unusual to have two, sometimes nearly 300 decisions made at a week of spiritual emphasis. How on earth? 300 at once. It's hard falling out 12. So we've got to get better at this.
Can you not use the TARDIS?
What's that?
Can you not use the TARDIS?
TARDIS. I didn't know what one of those was. Doctor Who is, isn't it?
Yeah.
All right, we're going to close with prayer, folks. Have the rest of the afternoon off, mate. We're going to meet tonight, and the shop opens tonight. Better book some food at 8:30. Great specials, Nick, or what? Thank you for coming, folks. God bless you as we work together to seek and save the lost. Let's bow our heads. And thank Christian, coming from Melbourne for us. Father, we thank you for your goodness and grace. It's so exciting to see the world getting ready for Jesus to come. I can't wait, Lord. But before it happens, there's a bit of work to do. May we be tireless, Lord. May we just work in cooperation with your Spirit to take every single interest as such a treasure, such a precious thing that's been given to us. Just bless and guide and help us become better at this, Lord, that we might finish your work sooner. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks.